Penguin Random House Audio presents The Erstwhile by B. Catling, read for you by Allan Corduner. Prologue. Too bruised be that slender, sturting spray out of the oak's rind that should betide a branch of girt and goodliness. Straightway her spring is turned on herself, and wried and knotted like some gall or veiny wen. Dayspring mishandled cometh not again. Rudyard Kipling, Gertrude's Prayer. London. This is where the man-beast crawls. Its once virtuous body turned inside out, made raw and skinless, growing vines and sinews backwards through the flesh. Stiff, primordial feathers pluming in its lungs, thorns and rust knotted to barbed wire in its loins. Guilt and fear have gnawed the fingertips away to let the claws hook out into talons. Sharpened by digging a home in a shallow grave, it is seen on all fours, naked, and worse across the broken ground on sharp knees that are red raw from chiseling the earth to gain some purchase. Prowling inside a trench, blinded by stark glares of explosions. Another bellowing flash sculpts the rippling muscle of its back and arms and the thick prophet's hair that has become soured by warfare into itching dreadlocks, mud-filled like the beard of dribble and tangled ginger grit. But it is the face that alarms, skinned alive by shock. The eyes terrified in the sudden phosphorus glare. Ultimately lost and forever in a gutter of staring that has emptied its skull. The small balding artist makes a further adjustment to their expression, widening the pupils, setting them in a squint, looking in different directions to give insight into the mind cleaving. He then steps away from the table, where the picture had been made, and nods to himself, his ink-stained fingers rubbing his chin. Yes, it was almost ready to be finalized for printing. A small noise on the other side of the room made him look up and drag his thought into the open. I say it's almost ready to be finalized. Someone or something was draped against the shabby curtain that was saturated in the stink of London. The artist took the picture from the table and held it up to show his subject and emphasize his words. I never looked like that, came the reply. You have caught me between worlds, upriver before I left the great forest and downriver after. You have gone and left me here alone, and all the other rumours have sailed over to the Dauphin's land to be torn apart in the mud, in the first of your world wars, of which there shall be many. It was difficult to understand the model, because he had been speaking in a vocabulary of shadows. He had not yet learned language. Instead, he spoke into the artist's mind telepathically, without words, which made the artist's mouth work unconsciously, trying to shape the sounds in his mind. For anyone else, this manner of communication could be shocking, but for this painter, it was just another day communing with the angels. The model said he was of the erstwhile, but this made no sense to the painter. He also referred to humans as rumours, with a capital R. It all seemed a bit delirious, and the waning day outside was blurring the edges of their meanings. The model's statement about a French trench in a future world war had not been understood. The night closed slower back then, the eye calibrated to dusk, and all the nuances that have since been removed and exiled by electricity. The city in these days was encrusted in an ancient gloom. The small wicks of the whale oil lamps glowed in every tarry hutch, doing little but adding a smoked glitter to the polished coral of London's darkness. A blind man, and there were many then, could tell of night's arrival by the change of smell as the whale oil's stench rose up against the departing light. The river held the tides in its deep, ragged throat for a moment before reversing its might under the command of a hidden moon. On the banks of the Thames, thousands of stacked wooden rooms creaked and shuddered. The painter protested. But it is you, exactly as you described it, as you looked before, Before you found me, it's you leaving that forest, fleeing that viewer you speak of. Vorrh. And I did not flee. This was transmitted in careful curves, with a new insistence in its pressures, forcing the artist to drop the picture and hold his head. The abruptness surprised the last particles of day. Do not write my name on this. If you must show it to others, say it is someone else. But who? What? Asked the confused artist. Nothing else looks like this. Then hide it. Bury it under others. Show no one. Burn it. But it shows another face of God, the artist said. God in the beast, and man declining, falling from grace. The model maintained his clarity while dissolving in the gloom. An ancient king, he thought, tossing it back in the wake of his leaving, and the wisp of it undid the pain in the artist's temples. He took his hands down and looked at his stained fingers, as if trying to match the same darkness in the pigment with that which was growing in the room. I will call it Nebuchadnezzar, he quietly called out, in the way one speaks to the final closed door of a departed lover, the fleeing absence of a once attentive listener. It became one of William Blake's greatest works. Part 1. Chapter 1. The old arrow was forgetting. The air had worn it thin. So many harsh landings, so many directions. It had sailed across time and place, slayed some men and saved others. The bow, however, stayed constant and vital. Its maroon and black curve was made of the flesh and bones of a divine woman, a priestess who had been born in the Vorrh. She had told her husband how to divide her flesh and remake it, to separate and shave the long bones, realigning their strength and grain, and how to bind their splints with her muscle fibers and tighten them with sinew and skin. Now the great Vorrh and all that dwelt within it watched as the undergrowth parted and the bow glided between the trees, twisting to avoid the hanging vines. Any human would have seen only the bow and arrow travelling by themselves, yet they were being held by Tsungali, slayer of men, warrior of the true people. The man who had led the Possession War uprising, he who had hunted the English bowman Williams, and been slain by the monster Sidrus in the process. These days, Tsungali was a ghost. A battle in this very forest had made him so. But those moments felt dim in his mind, receded, because ghosts have poor memories. They have only purpose, which for Tsungali was finding the final destination of the fatigued and last arrow. He travelled now with the spirit of his grandfather, who had guided him thus far and encouraged him on. Their journey was circular throughout the Vorrh. The process had taken many months. Tsungali shot the arrow forward and they followed it to places no human, or ghost for that matter, had ever set foot. Now it had taken them to the forest's edge. Tsungali's grandfather stopped before they made the next shot. He sat wheezing on a low rock. Tsungali felt him dissolving and turned towards the ancient man, who like him was a waft of his previous life. Then the old one summoned up a strong whisper and spoke again. Little son, we have done our duty, and I will stay now. The last part of this is yours alone. The grandson did not argue. He bent and hugged the great spirit who had been so much to him. The ancient man faded as they embraced. In the mottled sap-green sunlight, he was barely there. Tsungali turned and loaded the arrow and bent the bow. He let the next shot fly and felt the suction of separation as he left the Vorrh forever. The Vorrh did not recognize or want men trespassing its vastness, and any who did suffered a dismal erasure of mind. The Vorrh had its own time, its own climate, and its own mind. It was ancient before Adam was a supposed twinkle in God's eye. and so had few dealings with this troublesome species. The fabled monsters and ghosts that were permitted access to its core had a purpose and function that ran in opposition to the dreams and ambitions of humanity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.